Good morning. We're so glad you've decided to join us today. This is Woodlake Baptist Church Online, and my name is Krista Rowe. I'm a member here, and I also help out with the youth ministry with Brian and Jesse Lancaster. I'm coming on to give you a little bit of information on how you can stay up to date on what Woodlake is doing in the midst of COVID-19. The best way you can stay up to date is to be on our website. It's woodlakebaptistchurch.org. This is where the pastor will be putting updates up and we'll be posting our sermons. We also have a Facebook and Instagram page. Make sure you're liking those and following those. We're going to have the same updates on those. We're going to be posting, again, like I said, updates, but we're also going to be posting our sermons as well as encouraging words from our people. We want to see you. We miss you so much. So just seeing your faces on there really just lights all of us up. So we're so glad y'all are constantly bringing those videos in. Also, make sure that you are subscribed to our YouTube page because that's where all of our services are going to be stashed. So make sure you're on there. Make sure that you're getting those notifications as well. At the end of the service, we're going to have a time to give. We're going to post something on the screen for you, and it's going to show you how to do that online. But we also have a Dropbox here on campus. So make sure if you want to get out of the house, because I know all of us are wanting to get out, make sure that you go to not the first door, but the last door. It's going to be the brick column on the right, and it's going to have a black box. So make sure you just slip it in there. We are constantly checking that out to make sure that we can grab your tithes and offerings. Again, this is going to be at the end of the service, so make sure you have an opportunity to give. The drop box can be any day of the week. Finally, we want to do something fun with you guys. So make sure that after this, make sure that you are posting a picture of yourself and what your home church looks like. What does it look like to you today? How are you worshiping with us? We want you to post that and use the hashtag #WithWoodlake. That way we can all see what home church looks like for all of our members, and we can stay in contact because, again, we miss you guys so much. And we are so thankful once again that you've decided to join with us today. Have a great Sunday.
Good morning. Welcome to Woodlake. We're so happy to have you over the live stream this morning. We know you couldn't be here, but we're glad you joined us in. Let's sing "This Is Amazing Grace." Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth? Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen. If our God is for us, who can be against us? There's nothing our God can't do.
Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you.
Into the darkness you shine.
Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you.
Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. For us, then you could ever stop us. And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? Stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
Sing this out. Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God,
sing that again.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God.
Let's sing, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust him.
Jesus' cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me, need the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Thank you for this day that you've given us to be able to come and worship you, Lord. It may not be the normal way that we would come and worship you, Lord, even though the people are not here as we're recording this video. They're here with you this morning, watching and learning about your Lord, worshiping you, Lord. I pray for all those that are watching in that they're staying home and they're safe and that your hand is over them, healing them, and keeping them safe. Lord, I pray for those that are sick this morning, that you continue to guide them and you have your healing hand over them. Lord, there's nothing that you can't do. There's nothing that's impossible for you, Lord. Lord, you move the mountains. I pray for Brother Jerry as he brings the message this morning that we open our hearts and go out and disciple to others. In your name I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, Wood Lake Baptist Church. It's so wonderful to be here. I'm glad you're all tuning in. Let me just say just a few things before we get started. I want you to take your Bibles and find Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. We're going to start in verse 17 this morning. And I've got a few things just to let you know. Listen, don't forget to go to the website. There's so many things there for you. Words of encouragement. You can see past sermons and lessons, things of that nature. We've got some lay people that have made some videos for you just to encourage you. We're going to do some more of those. So if you've already seen the ones that are on there now, there'll be some new things on there for you coming pretty soon. Great words of encouragement. I wanted to say thank you. Pat yourself on the back. You've been so gracious during this awesome time of crisis, this terrible time, but you've been awesome with your giving, and I just pray you continue to do that. We're going to keep doing ministry, and let's just keep praying that this is over as quickly as we can get it over with so that we can get back to being together. I want to tell you, man, just as your pastor, how much I love you and how much I miss you. It is just terrible not being able to see you. Sanctuary was only a little skeleton crew of us here that are taping. I want to say thank you to the production crew. And you say, Brother Jerry, do you really have a production crew? Let me tell you, this is a production. They are working very hard, and I appreciate their help so much. And folks, we prayed for the Lord to send us some great folks to help us, and he has done that. And I want to say thank you, God, for that. We want to just say thank you from the bottom of our hearts to everybody. You just be blessed today. I miss you very much. Do me a favor, check on your friends, check on your neighbors, and mostly check on the people that you know here at Woodlake. And I hope that these videos and our services are getting better and better as we learn more and tweak things. And I hope that it'll just be better every week as you tune in. So now, let's have a quick word of prayer, and then we're going to get started. You find Mark chapter 10 and verse number 17. Father, we love you. I pray that your spirit would come down. I pray that you'd use me today just to reach out and touch by way of video our folks and be a blessing to them as we answer the most important question that a person could ask. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. Well, let me taxi for a minute and tell you where we are in our context. We're quickly moving to a different area in our time, our Bible study. You'll know we've been in Palestine. We've been in the northern section. We moved back down. Jesus has been in Capernaum. He's been there. And now we're going to move a little bit south. Jesus is getting a little bit closer to Jerusalem. So this is actually where we're going to be, is in Perea. And chapter number 10, Jesus moves, gets a little bit closer to Bethany and Jerusalem and Jericho. We're actually on the southeastern side of the Jordan River. Jesus will be there. And then, of course, in the lessons to come, the sermons to come, Jesus is going to get a little bit closer and closer and closer to Jerusalem, so that in just a little bit, the triumphal entry will happen. And then this kind of covert messianic activity that we've had is going to come to an end. Jesus has been spending a lot of time with his disciples. When the triumphal entry happens, it's a game on. Jesus is going to be out in the open. He is going to be fulfilling prophecy that from the Old Testament speaks of how literally the very time that Jesus comes and gives himself as a ransom for many. In Mark 10:45, we read there, and it shows us that this book, as wonderful as it is, has been divided into two sections. We are soon going to be moving away from Jesus the servant, healing and teaching and ministering, and he is going to be giving his life as a ransom for many. There's a couple of sections here. You'll notice in chapter 10 that Pastor is actually just skipping because I've just preached on those not too long ago. There's a section on divorce and a section on that Jesus, how he loved the little children. Well, we just went through all those things. So I'm going straight over into Mark chapter 10 and verse number 17. I'm calling this the inquisitive young ruler because he is very inquisitive. I'll give you an outline in just a second. Hey, let's read our text together and you'll see where we are in verse number 17. Beautiful passage of scripture that we're going to look at today. And as he was setting out on a journey, verse 17, a man ran up to him, and the man knelt down and he began asking him, "Good teacher, What shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments, do not murder and do not commit adultery, do not steal and do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and your mother. And he said to him, teacher, I have kept all of these ever since I was a little boy or ever since from youth growing up. And looking at him, Jesus felt love for him. And he said to him, one thing that you lack, go and sell all your possessions, give it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. And then he said, come, follow me. That's where the rubber meets the road right there. But at these words, his face fell, and he went away, and he was grieved, for he was one who owned much property. And Jesus, looking around, said to the disciples, how hard is it, or how hard will it be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God? And the disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus answered again and said to them, children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of heaven? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And as they were there, he says, and they were even more astonished. And they said to him, then who can be saved? And looking upon them, Jesus said, with men it is impossible, but with God for all things, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. Peter began to say to him, behold, we have left everything and we have followed you. And Jesus said, truly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or farms for my sake and for the gospel's sake, but that he shall receive 100 times as much now in this present age, houses and brothers and sisters and mother and children and farms, along with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. Well, let me introduce you to this section of Scripture. I tell you, there is not a better question that you could ask yourself today. This one question, it's, how can I get to heaven? I remember when I was a kid, there used to be this commercial that came on, and I still remember it. And it was a Fram oil filter. Some of our older folks will remember this a little better than our young people because it hasn't been on in a very long time. But the punchline sounded a little bit like this. You can pay me now or you can pay me later. And the implication from the folks who sold the Fram oil filters was this. You can pay a little bit more now for our oil filter and it'll do you a good job. And then a little bit later on, you won't have to pay for an entire engine because you went cheap now. And then right before they would go off the air and the commercial would go off, the man would stand up and he'd say, you can pay me now or you can pay me later. Well, I like that commercial and I remember that. I'd like to say it this way. You can pay now and play later, or you can play now and pay later. Rick Offord used to say this to me, my dear friend who's gone to be with the Lord. He would say, there's always time to do it right the second time. You see, if you'll sacrifice up front and do it right the first time, truthfully, you're going to save time and money because you won't waste time and then have to do it over anyway. Well, right here in our text, Jesus used pretty much the same phrasing and the phraseology in his statement. Jesus says it this way. The first will be last, and the last will be first. Now, in this great passage, there's a few passages within this that you know and love and you remember, and you love this passage. There's a lot of great scriptures that are in this passage. It's just a truly good word for all of us. You see, the most important decisions that we make in life, this passage helps us to understand one thing about the decisions of life. They're made in this life. If the rapture of the church were to happen today, you're fixed in the state that you're in. You see, in this life and in this time, you're going to choose your destiny. You're going to choose the rewards that you're going to have in the next life. But you do that in this life. Wherever you go when you die, and you will die, we all are going to die. And once you were born, your soul was an eternal soul. Everybody lives forever. The question will be, where will you spend eternity? Your destiny is set right now. You can pay me now or you can pay me later. But one way or the other, the calling card always comes to the door. You can't beat this. This question that this man asked Jesus has to be answered. You're going to get rewards in the next life based on what you do in this life. Your character is set in this life. You build it here. Your influence is fixed once you die. Your eternal life, your decisions that you make about where you're going will be done in this life. You pay now or you pay later. If you are first in this life and selfish and don't sacrifice, you will have to pay in the next. If you reject the offer of salvation in this life, you will seal your fate in the next one. Now, I want you to look in verse number 17. I'm going to call this first section here the inescapable search. This search, this question is very, very important. And then in verses 18 through 25, we're going to look at the unattainable requirements. I'm going to talk about salvation and why you can't attain it on your own. And then the last part is the best part. But we're going to call this section the impossible made possible. We're going to see how Jesus has done everything that needs to take place that will be done for you. It has already been done for you. All you have to do is receive it. Now let's look at this little question here. The inescapable search. This is not a new search. This is a search, this is a question that this inquisitive young ruler came to ask the Lord. This question is literally the cause of every ism that we have today. And you can pretty much bank on it that mostly every ism, for instance, humanism, every ism that I've ever read about or learned about is just about ungodly. It will take you in the wrong direction. All of the isms that have been introduced into our world are a direct result of this one question that this rich young ruler came and asked the Lord Jesus. The question still remains today. Man is born with this question, how can I get to heaven? It is the question that is tattooed on our heart when we come into this world because we're separated from the Lord. It is my belief that God Himself literally puts that question into your heart and into your mind when you come into this world. And man, from the first moment he is big enough or he grows into the place where he can think for himself and he understands morality, he begins to try to understand the world in which he lives. He starts trying to answer that question. Man is born with this in his heart. And if you were given one opportunity to sit down and talk to the Lord Jesus, I want to tell you, this man asked the right question. It is a good question. It is the most important question. And if this question is not answered correctly, nothing else in your life will actually matter. Now, I really think this man was serious. Notice what the scripture says. Mark actually tells us that the man ran to Jesus and he knelt and he asked the Lord. He uses a very specific phrasing in this question. He doesn't just say, Lord, how can I get to heaven? He says, Lord, how can I inherit eternal life? There's a lot of truth and a lot of theology there. The question here has been asked zillions and zillions of times. I really believe that with all my heart. And men today are still asking the question. This question has been in the hearts of men for centuries. They have even literally changed the question. They've even changed heaven. Men have changed heaven. Many times people will talk about nirvana because they couldn't find out or figure out this question about to get to heaven, so they just created their own place to go to. They created new rules in order to be able to get to the heaven that they created. I guess I've heard probably hundreds of jokes, and I've laughed at these jokes just like you have, but how many jokes have you heard about St. Peter being at the pearly gates? and he's telling people and giving them the requirements for how you get in to heaven. You see, this subject, this question, has been on the hearts of men. Rock bands have even taken the name. There's one band that calls themselves Nirvana. It is the heartbeat of man to want to know the answer to this question. Philosophers and poets have literally made this the subject of their poems, of their muses, their paradigms for centuries. Songwriters, I would be probably over the millennia, probably thousands and millions maybe even, songs have been written about this subject, about heaven and how to get there. Just think of all the spirituality that the Beatles tried to put in their music, but they never really could completely answer the question. And our efforts literally to appease the fear in the hearts of men have tried to do away with the question literally altogether. Man tries to do away with the existence of God because he can't answer this question when the answer is there all along. Well, while we're going to get rid of God and while we're going to maybe just get rid of heaven itself, the next thing is men will even try to get rid of hell because they can't answer the question. Some can't make this big of a decision, so they will just, well, we'll cool hell off. We'll make it a place where we go to. This is not such a bad place after all. The rich young ruler, he comes to Jesus and he asks this question. Jesus looks straight into the heart of this man. Jesus goes past all of the things and goes right to this man's need. Mark tells us that Jesus, literally in verse 21, this just does my heart so good that it says that Jesus loved him. He didn't miss heaven. He didn't miss getting this answer to his question because he wasn't loved and cared for. He was cared for. The scripture specifically tells us here that Jesus loved this man. And as he does all people, what did this man really want to know? Well, what he really wanted to know was very simple. How can I inherit eternal life, but how much of the world can I still keep in my life and still get to heaven? You say, Brother Jerry, how do you know that? Well, we're going to see that a little bit further into the story. How worldly can I be and still get to heaven? The real question is this. Can I be first in this life and still get to heaven? Can I play now and get paid later? And I want to tell you, this story, this question, this decision will come down to you. And when you're trying to answer this question, you're going to be faced with a very important decision in just a moment. And I'm going to show you how to make that decision. I really do with all of my heart. What breaks my heart when I read this story is I believe that the man really was sincere. Mark tells us that this man, this young ruler, ran to Jesus. It wasn't very popular or cool or culturally sound in those days for men to run in the streets. But he ran. He saw Jesus and he went to him very quickly. And not only did he run to him, he falls down upon his knees. He kneels before the Lord. He does this out in the open. He's not embarrassed. He's not afraid. He's not fearful. He does this in front of everyone. I think the man really did want to have eternal life. I think that the man was aware of his sin. I think he was aware of his shame. We're not told a whole lot about him, but I really think that he understood that he was a sinner. I think that he dealt with the guilt day in and day out. I think it burdened him. There's so many people in this world right now that I know that have come to the place because they can't answer the question. They're still dealing with the guilt and the shame and the pain of their own sin that they end up hating God. They turn against God and they try to stand against anything that is called God or godly or holy or good. I think this man really was a good man. I think he wanted to know. And this is what breaks my heart because he was ever so close to the kingdom of God. He tried to do what was right, but he couldn't. He couldn't. He recognizes, though, that Jesus was different from all the other people. Here is our Lord. He's healing people. He's a good man. He uses two important words here. Notice what the man says. He says, I want to inherit the kingdom of God. This little Greek word here, this is to get something that is by apportionment. Now, a person doesn't get an inheritance from themselves. This is something that is apportioned to you. It comes from somewhere else. You don't get your own inheritance. Someone has to give you something that doesn't belong to you. In other words, it's a possession from another source. So he says, Lord, I want to inherit. I want to get something. I would even go as far as to say that it's something we don't deserve. Many times we'll have a long-lost relative. Some of you are waiting on that long-lost relative that you didn't know to go ahead and kick the bucket, and this big inheritance comes to you. You may not have known them. You didn't know who they were, but all of a sudden here is this inheritance that comes to you, and oh, what a blessing it is. It comes from another source. And then he uses the word life. He says, I want to inherit eternal life. This is the Greek word that refers to not only just life, it refers to the source of life. This is the word that's used in the New Testament that talks about eternal life. This is a really, really, really good question that this man asks the Lord. He runs to the Lord. He kneels down and he says, Lord, I want the eternal life that I can't get myself. I want the eternal life that comes from a source that I do not know of. And I see something in you, and you are a good teacher. You are a good man. And I want that eternal life. This question is really such a good question, but what breaks my heart is this man did not get what he wanted, and he was so close to the kingdom of God, it breaks my heart. And then he ends up walking away. It's really sad. Many people find themselves so close. Many of the dictators in our world today, they try to take God's place. The atheist and the agnostic, they don't want God to exist at all. Liberals want God to be all mercy and no justice. The humanist thinks that they're capable. They think they're capable of doing things better than God. The religionist will create their own God. You can adopt any philosophy. You can adopt any paradigm. But I want to say to you, this glaring question, no matter who you are, no matter what you believe, no matter what you hold to, this question will never leave you. It will never go away. It is an unquenching, it is an insatiable desire within man to answer this question. G.K. Chesterton said, truth sits on the lips of dying men. And whatever you believe, you listen to Pastor Jerry very carefully. Whatever you believe, you're going to have to take it to the grave with you. And you may be someone today who has that pride, and you think you're going to make it, and you don't need God. But when you're dying, whatever you believe, you're going to have to take it with you. Do you remember the struggle that Luther had? Luther wanted to please God so desperately. He beat himself. He tortured himself. He would lie naked in the snow. He did everything that he possibly could do to please God Almighty, and he never, ever could do it. Finally, he came to the place while he was translating the Greek New Testament into German so that the people of Germany could understand the Word of God. He came to the place in the book of Romans where it says that the just shall live by faith, and it clicked. He finally understood. He understood the same thing that this man never got. But look, this man said, Lord, listen to me, what must I do to inherit eternal life? There is nothing that you can do to inherit eternal life. It's a gift. The just shall live by faith. Master, the inescapable question, Master, what should I do to inherit eternal life? The second point, 18 through 25, the unattainable requirements. This discourse continues with the man. It is a very interesting discourse as well. And Jesus basically tells the man, he helps him to understand he can't attain these requirements. Jesus starts by saying, do you know the commandments? Jesus really tells the man something staggering. And some 2,000 or more years later, I'm going to give you the same answer. Jesus says, do you know the commandments? Jesus didn't even talk about all of the commandments of God. He just simply said, how about the Ten Commandments in verses 18 and 19? He just mentions a few of them. Notice that the man has all of this pride. Jesus says to him, in other words, have you kept the commands? Have you been perfect, in other words? You said, Brother Jerry, are you kidding me? Do I have to be perfect to get into heaven? Absolutely, you have to be perfect. I'll explain that a little bit more in just a minute. But notice the pride that the man has. Teacher, I have kept all these since I was a youth. Well, Houston, we have a little bit of a problem right here. One of the sons of Adam is saying that he's kept all of the commands of God. And I want to tell you, when Adam fell, we fell. We have the same nature as our forefather Adam, and we absolutely, positively cannot keep. We cannot keep the commands. And I'm going to take you one step even further. I've heard people say this before. Well, Brother Jerry, if you actually could keep all the commands, if you could keep every one of them perfectly, then you could go to heaven because you wouldn't have any sin in your life. Well, I got news for you. When you came into this world, you came in this world as a sinner before you ever broke one of God's laws because you were a descendant of Adam and you came into this world separated from God. That's why that we say, and that's why Jesus told Nicodemus, you have to be born again. Because the first birth you had put you in a bad position. It put you in a position of being separated from God. Even Jesus, listen, Jesus talked about the commands in this way. He says, I didn't come to destroy the law, but I came to fulfill it. And that's your key to heaven. Because the Son of God fulfilled the commands for you and me. Listen, Jesus, even when he spoke about the Pharisees, took the keeping of the law to another level. Listen to these passages in Matthew chapter 5. You'll recognize them through the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard that it was said long ago, but I say to you, Jesus took the law another step. You've heard that it was said murder's wrong. But Jesus says, I say to you, if you're angry with your brother, you've committed murder. He talks about adultery. He says, you've heard that to have adultery is wrong. He says, I'll tell you this. If you've looked at a woman and lusted after her in your heart, you've committed adultery. He says, if anyone divorces his wife, that he must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for marital unfaithfulness, causes her to become an adulteress. I tell you, I do my very best to exegete and take the Word of God in context and to preach it to you with spirit and in truth. But did you know, I can't wait till I get to heaven and I can sit around and let the Lord Jesus explain the Word of God to you. We're going to find out that we're not as sharp as we think we are. He says to the people, you've heard that it says don't break your oath. Jesus said, I tell you, don't swear by heaven or earth. He goes on and on and on. And the rabbis took these things and they kind of found a way to sneak out of the truth of the laws. Jesus took it to another step. Here was this man. Jesus just mentioned one simple thing, the Ten Commandments, and he says, you can't even keep those things. It's an impossibility. Paul tells us there's no one righteous, not even one. In verse 21, we see this great revealing. Jesus knows exactly what to say to each and every individual. I want to tell you, this will be a blessing to you. Pay attention. Don't drift on me. Listen to Pastor. I've witnessed to countless people. I felt like the Lord was moving. The Holy Spirit was convicting. Only before the end of the witness, those people to reject Christ, walk away, and I would go away feeling like I was a failure. I want to encourage you with this. Look right what happened. Look, this is right in the text. Pastor doesn't even have to bolster this one bit. This happened in the text. Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, the most winsome personality, the God of all ages, there, the scripture says he loved the man. The atmosphere was right. The mood was right. He's talking to the Son of God. And what does he do? The man walked away from salvation. Friend, I want to tell you, there was something else going on in this man's heart that we didn't know about. Well, it's going to be revealed to us here in just a second. But I want to encourage you. Do you understand that this man was talking to the Savior himself and the witness was not completed in a salvation experience. Don't give up. Do what God's called you to do and share the gospel. Jesus knows what's going on. Here is the point of commitment. Jesus says to him, listen, it's a point of commitment. Go sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and then come follow me. Oh, wait a minute. He says, here's what you lack, one thing. You lack one thing. Can I say to you, the man was so close, he lacked one thing, and then he would have been in heaven. I'm telling you, if he had done this, this man would have come and followed Jesus. He would be there. When we get to heaven, we would have met him. But Jesus says, you lack one thing. Make this commitment. Go and sell everything you have and come follow me. The word hustereo means here, to fall short. That reminds me of a passage of Scripture. For all have sinned and they fall short of the glory of God. There's so many people who will fall short. They will get so close. And the Bible says Jesus loved him. He says to him, son, trust me. I'm going to take care of you. Go sell everything that you have on earth and I will give you treasure in heaven. The word for treasure there is the word thesaurus. It's a rich, it's a repository, it's a deposit. Listen to me. Here's what the man did. He weighed and valued all of the things. The scripture tells us that he had a lot of land. This was a wealthy man. He had a lot of stuff. He had a lot of things. And in a moment, he weighed it. He put it in the balance. He put it on the scales. And the precious blood of Jesus Christ that could have been his. All the things of glory could have been his. What is it that's in this world today that would keep you from coming to the Lord Jesus? What can you put on the scales that would be more valuable than the gift of eternal life with the Son of God? This man made a tragic, tragic, tragic decision. And he did it in a blink of an eye, just simply in a moment. Jesus offered him the comparison between heavenly things and earthly things. And his choice was to take things that moss and rust and wind and rain can decay and tear apart and destroy. In these days, he says, come, follow me. The word here for come, follow me simply means to get in my way. To follow in my footsteps, to be my disciple, to accompany me. Sell it all, give it away, just leave it behind and come and accompany the Lord on his journey. Riches and pride and morality and intelligence and education and works and heritage, a tradition, position, and even embarrassment have kept people from coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. I've seen people right in this sanctuary. They'd be embarrassed. They're under conviction. And they'd be embarrassed to come down and say, Pastor, I'm lost. I need to give Christ my heart. To follow Jesus Christ means to surrender, to give it up, to come and be with him. Notice verse 22. The Bible says this. The man went away grieved. He went away sorrowful. He went away sad. He was rich and he had a lot of stuff. But how ironic, considering that Jesus gave up glory and heaven and all of glory for us. And this man would not leave his worldly goods long enough to come to Jesus Christ. The disciples were asked to leave and follow. And guess what they did? They got up and walked away and they went with the Lord. Remember, dear friend, there is nothing that you're going to take with you from this life. I want to tell you, I don't care how many billions that Michael Bloomberg has. When he leaves this world, he's taking nothing with him. And he better had answered this question. Recently, he talked about how good he had been to humanity. And when he gets to heaven, they're just going to walk him through the pearly gates because they'll be proud that he's there. And I want to tell you, he is going to get a really big shock when he gets there and he finds out they don't care who you are. They want to know what you've done with the Lord Jesus Christ. In verses 23 through 25, those who think See, this is what's hard. Jesus even illustrates it. This is what's so hard. He says, it's like getting a rich man. He says, it's like getting a camel through the eye of a needle. And it doesn't mean that rich people can't go to heaven. But here's what Jesus is trying to say. That those people who have the comforts of life don't understand the real needs that they have. And I want to promise you, this life is quick. It's passing away quickly. It'll be gone before you know it. And there's nothing here that can bring comfort to a heart, a mind, and a soul in everyday life. I want to say to you, the main point here is that getting into heaven without God's grace is absolutely impossible. The last thought on this section. Notice this and hear me well. The scripture doesn't tell us that once this man walked away, he ever got another chance. I say this at times when we have visitors at Wood Lake and people come in and I share the gospel with them and I never know when they leave and they don't come back or why they didn't come back. It may be the last chance that they ever get to hear the gospel. Now listen, here's the last section. This is so beautiful. The impossible made possible. In verses 26 through 31. In verse 26, I want you to understand the disciples see what's going on. This is absolutely beautiful. And so Jesus is talking about how difficult it is for people to get to heaven. As a matter of fact, in the text, Jesus actually says it's just impossible. It's hard for people to get into the kingdom. And then the disciples, I guess, they start looking at each other and they start looking at the Lord and they say, well, Lord, who can be saved? I really believe with all my heart. They were thinking, one of the disciples says, Lord, we've left everything for you. And they were kind of reminding Jesus, hey, this guy wouldn't leave his stuff and he's doomed. But Lord, don't forget that we actually did do that. And Jesus says, you're absolutely right. Jesus says, you're positively, you are right. You see, in that day, wealth was seen as the favor of God. And here the disciples are looking at this man who has a lot of wealth. And he just didn't come to Christ. He just wasn't getting that question answered. He wasn't at the place of commitment. And they saw for a minute, here they are thinking culturally, wow, here's a guy who has a lot of money. He's got favor with God already, and he can't be saved. Then we're in trouble, fellas. And Peter's really saying, Lord, what about us? And Jesus calms him down, and he says it's okay. In verse 27, Jesus plainly tells the disciples, he's trying to teach them that the salvation that God gives us and how the Lord saves us is a work of God. He says, yes, with men these things are impossible, but with God all things are possible. In Romans chapter 8, you know verse 28, all things work together for good to them who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. But by the time you get down to verse 29, he says, for these God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he called. And those he called, he justified. And those he justified, he glorified. I want to tell you from start to finish, the work of salvation is a work of God. And the Lord has made provision for you and for me. And the Lord will call you. If he has chosen you, he will call you. If he calls you, he will justify you. And when you are justified, you will be glorified. What things are impossible with man are possible with God. May I say to you that if it were not a work of God, none of us would be saved. Ephesians chapter 1 speaks of the Father choosing us. He speaks of the Son redeeming us. And he speaks of the Spirit sealing us. From start to finish, salvation is a work of God. R.G. Lee says that God is the hound of heaven. I want to say when you come into this world, the Lord puts this question in your heart. How do I get eternal life? What is there beyond the grave? Why am I here? What has happened in this world? How did we get in that shape? Folks, these are the things, these are the parts of the questions about salvation and eternal life that you must answer. Christianity is the only doctrines, it is the only plan of salvation that is there that answers origin, where we came from, condition, how did we get in the shape that we're in, salvation, how do we get out of it, and destiny, where are we going at the end of it? Christianity answers every one of those questions. The disciples really did leave everything and follow Jesus. These verses, verses 29 and 30, have the greatest promise in Scripture in them. You say, Brother Jerry, hold on a minute now. Do you, I mean, really? Brother Jerry, are you telling us the truth? Well, I want to read this to you again. I want you to show you something in this verse. This the inquisitive young ruler walked away from something pretty special because he had a lot of riches. He had a lot of land. But right here in this verse, these two verses, this is the greatest promise in Scripture. You say, Brother Jerry, you better back this up. Well, I want to read it to you. And it may be something in these verses that you've read before, but you skipped over it. You didn't see it like you should have. Now, let's read it. And when I get there, I'm going to stop. In verse number 29, he says, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or farms for my sake and for the gospel's sake, but that he shall receive 100 times as much. The Lord promises you that there is absolutely nothing. The promise of God is this: there is nothing that you can give up in this world that will not be blessed 100-fold when you get to heaven. But one more word. You may have missed this. What's the next word? Verse 30. But that he shall receive 100 times as much now in this present age. Let me listen. I may not be a rich man, but I want to promise you in Jesus' name, there is nothing that I walked away from when I gave my life to Christ that I would go back to right now and say that was better than what I have right now. I want to tell you, I can take one thing and say to you that the knowledge that I have of the Word of God, the fruit of the Holy Spirit in my life, the habits that I've overcome, the spirituality that the Lord has worked in my life, the wisdom that I have now, the knowledge of the future and what is to come, that I tell you, what I 100-fold, I would say that I'm blessed millions times over compared to what I used to be, what I used to have. I want to say to you that Jesus says to his disciples, don't fret, this man missed it, but you walked away from everything, and boy, do I have a deal for you. I want to say to you, coming up pretty soon, I'm getting pretty close to 40 years of walking with Jesus. I want to tell you, I'm a satisfied customer. There's absolutely nothing, nothing. I promise you, I'm standing in the pulpit. God is my witness. I call the Holy Spirit of God as my witness. You could fill this sanctuary full of gold bars, and all I would have to do to get it is take Jesus out of my heart for 30 seconds, and I'll tell you, you can keep your gold. There's nothing as valuable as having the blessings that God has given us. Listen, how do I inherit eternal life? Jesus says, the first will be last. The last will be first. You see, what did this man need? This man needed one moment of commitment. All he had to do, I promise you, if he had gone and shown the Lord the seriousness of his heart, does this mean that if you go and sell everything you own and then come back that you're saved? No, but it means that if you commit, if you're willing to commit that much. But you see, the Lord has not even required anyone else that I know of is doing that, except for in one moment in time you come to the Lord and your heart and your mind is committed solely to the Lord Jesus Christ, and you're willing to say, Lord, I want to give you my life. You see, that really, this is what we do when we pray. And when I lead someone to a prayer of faith in Christ, I say to them, do you give the Lord your life? Do you give him your heart? Do you make him your master and your Lord? Do you give him your all? There's nothing held back. You give him all yourself. Folks, that's salvation. What breaks my heart is this man was so very close. Would you put yourself right now, would you put yourself in the place of this rich young ruler? Lord, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? Would you receive Jesus Christ today as your personal Savior? If you'd pray that prayer, I would pray with all my heart that you would call me here at Woodlake Baptist Church and let me know that you want to answer that question. How do I inherit eternal life? It's by way of the cross. It's by way of the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you give him your heart today? Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that, Lord, the word has been preached with clarity. Jesus tells the disciples in this text that in the age to come, he speaks about eternal life in the age to come. Lord, that tells me there is going to be an age to come. And I pray that folks are ready. I pray that they would sacrifice now anything and everything to come to the full knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you that this message has the power to save if men will give their lives to Christ. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. God bless you. I'll see you soon.